Penguin Random House Audio presents Unraveled, The Life and Death of a Garment. This is the author, Maxine Bedat.
To my father, Keith, and Jennifer's father, Kevin, who helped us believe in our own voices, and my daughter, Leontine, and the generations that follow. Introduction.
Billed as the marketplace of the world, New York's Jacob Javits Center stood before me like a glass fortress. As a novice in the fashion world, I was intimidated by the prospect of entering the building for the 2013 Market Menswear Trade Show, where buyers from across the country were descending to find the goods that would land on their shelves. I grew up in Minnesota, home of the Mall of America, the largest mall in the United States. So I thought I could handle retail on a scale as grand as this. But that morning, I felt humbled by what seemed to be the aggregate of all the malls in the world, complete with the familiar convention center aroma of antifreeze and undertones of coffee and pizza grease. My business partner and I were getting ready to launch our new e-commerce site for clothing and select homewares, Zadie. We wanted to present about 50 pieces, shirts, pants, and accessories for women and men, curated from brands that aligned with our philosophy and aesthetic. The goal was to unearth beautiful, artisanal products. So that day in September, I was on a mission to find possible goods and brands for the site.
Approaching the enormous main atrium, I felt a chill set in, literal and metaphorical. The other buyers I could see were out for the kill, silently judging and scanning the racks of clothing and signage that stretched as far as the eye could see. Not quite knowing where to start, I walked the length of the space, stopping any time a collection caught my eye. I approached the first sales representative with what I thought was a simple question. "Can you tell me where your collection is made?" He responded with a blank stare, followed by a shrug of the shoulders, then averted his eyes. I couldn't believe it. Why wasn't he answering me? Didn't he know where his own goods were manufactured? I continued down the aisle until another collection caught my eye. I asked the same question of the woman at the booth. "Asia," she responded shortly, seemingly upset. What was with these people? Asia has 48 countries and 4.7 billion inhabitants. So while ever so slightly more specific than the first man's grunt, this information was not entirely helpful. I walked on. It didn't get better. Clothes, it turned out, were being made abroad in the Orient, or, to be super precise, China. What the hell? How did the people responsible for selling clothing to the entire US market not know something as basic as where that clothing was made? Also, the 1960s called and wants its offensive language back. Even saying something was designed in New York, I soon realized, was often code for made in China. After a long day trudging through Javits with zero business cards and not optimistic for Zadie's future, I left frustrated, confused, and skeptical. Having recently graduated from law school, I was not afraid of research and quickly applied those skills to find companies that knew who made their clothes. In September 2013, we launched the business with diverse partners, including Imogene and Willie, a company cutting and sewing denim in Tennessee, and Claire Vivier, whose colorful bags were produced in Los Angeles. We interviewed the designers and those responsible for production to tell the story behind every piece we carried, an attempt to give the customer the novel experience of knowing who made their things, down to the individual. We embedded a map on our site to show where the products came from, educating customers more deeply than the brand reps at Javits. We had thought it would be enough to explain where each article was made, as in what the label inside the garment would say. But we soon realized that wasn't enough. Our cashmere sweater was made in Italy, in that it was where the yarn was knit into a sweater. But the yarn was not spun in Italy, and the goats whose wool fiber became yarn roamed the steppes of Mongolia. The cold weather of the steppes helps produce soft fibers. Some of the brands knew where they purchased their yarn or finished textiles, but that didn't mean they knew where those companies, in turn, had purchased the leather or cotton, wool, or polyester fibers. We tried to find a company, one single company, that we could promote through Zadie that was addressing these issues of transparency and knowledge, who knew the story of their clothes. but we could not. Not a single company knew the full life story of their garments, from the farm or oil rig that created the fibers to the factories and people responsible for spinning, weaving, dyeing, cutting, and sewing. As we dug deeper, we also realized that the tags ignored something else, the environmental impact. Apparel production was increasing precipitously, doubling in the 15 years between 2000 and 2015. 100 to 150 billion new pieces of clothing produced annually, according to a range of reports. We soon realized that the earlier stages of the production cycle, raw material and fabric production, had the highest environmental footprint, but also garnered the least attention. Fashion companies were just beginning to market products as sustainable, but it was clear that that word was all but meaningless. So we ventured to do it ourselves. We made a wool sweater named 0.01 The Sweater, with the intention of being transparent and sustainable with every facet of how it would be made. The wool came from a ranch in Oregon, was washed in South Carolina, dyed and spun into yarn in Pennsylvania, and knit into a sweater in California. We launched the sweater alongside a very simple explanation of the social and environmental impacts that all clothing has. The response was overwhelming, not just from customers who were delighted to connect to their clothes, but from other companies, companies much, much larger than ours. "Thank you," they said, "for putting together the information on the impacts of clothing. It was really helpful for me and my team." I should not have been shocked, but I was. It wasn't just that customers were ignorant of the impact of the fashion industry. So was the industry, which had blinded itself to its own inner workings, and consequently, its own catastrophic consequences. I got into fashion as an outsider, and still see myself as one. My path into the world of clothing began not in fashion school, but in law school and through work at the United Nations. One summer, I was dispatched to Arusha, Tanzania, working at the International Criminal Tribunal for Rwanda. I spent my weekends doing my fair share of wandering, and in Arusha, on a weekend, any wandering will lead you to a market. These gatherings of makers, growers, and entrepreneurs were vibrant, joyful, and irresistible to my 20-something self. At first, I used these shopping trips to find souvenirs to bring back home. The more time I spent there, though, the more I realized I was getting more than just gifts I thought my relatives and friends would find pretty. I started to form relationships with the people who were making some of the things that I was buying. The woman who made my cool, yet classic floral shorts. The man who wove the baskets I hung on my walls. Visiting those markets, where the fabrics, colors, and patterns were rich with cultural significance, I also came to value the beauty of handcrafted work. Beyond the odd trip to the farmer's market, I really had never had meaningful interactions with the people and places behind what I consumed. The conversations and discoveries I had at that market would return to me in the months and years after. I started to connect the dots between the sustainable development goals the UN folks were so focused on and the things we purchased. That is to say, environmental degradation and poverty, for example, were both tied to how our things are made and paid for and how we use them. How global trade relationships are structured are a major determinant of whether people have the opportunity to make things and earn a living to begin with. At the same time, the craftspeople I met showed exceptional creative talent and an entrepreneurial drive. They had what it took to make livelihoods that were sustainable for their families, communities, and the planet. What if I could make a business out of working with people like that? Artisans whose talents customers would be pleased to know about and support with their purchase power. Eventually, that impulse led me to co-found Zadie, which then led me to the Javits Center, confronted with the realities of the fashion industry. As Zadie evolved, I kept digging deeper. If I was really most interested in advancing sustainability, was the best vehicle to do that a company whose business model, when it came down to it, was to sell more things? And since citizens and the industry itself had proven to not know its own impact, could I play a more helpful role by bringing that information to light? Eventually, I decided to stop selling clothing and focus all my attention instead on explaining the fashion industry's real impact. I connected with experts who understood every aspect of fashion's impact on our world. Agronomists, climate scientists, historians, fashion executives, factory executives, and material scientists, labor experts, organizers, and laborers, political scientists, toxicologists, psychologists, marketers, and economists, to launch a research and action think tank, a step above your average think tank where ideation stops at the whiteboard. The New Standard Institute, NSI, is an effort to use information.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.